Hello to everyone. We are here with antifono.gr to have an interview with Ms. Jelena Popovic, the director of the film Man of God. And we offer the wonderful hospitality, and we will speak about a series of subjects and issues related to the movie Man of God. Mrs. Jelena Popovic, thank you for the hospitality, for the wonderful hospitality.
Well, first of all, thank you for coming. It's wonderful seeing you and having you here.
My first question would be, how did you first decide to make a film on Saint Nektarios? Was there personal motives? How did you come up with this idea?
To make the film. And now to think about this question that I've been asked many times before. But as time goes by, maybe it gives me a little more time to think about it. May audience forgive me if I have to repeat a couple of things just for the sake of the truth of what really happened. Is this, that I actually, before I read a book about Saint Nektarios, I didn't even have anything in mind about making a film about the saint. Even though I loved reading about the saints, and that was something that was very personal to me, it gave me courage. I felt inspired and empowered by them, by their stories. I never thought of making a film about a saint. Clearly, when in 2012, after my father passed away, it was a year of his him passing away, I went to Belgrade. It was summer of 2012. I also visited this monastery next door, close to where I grew up. It's in the place called Rakovica. It's a monastery where our deceased Patriarch Paul was buried. I have never met Patriarch Paul, but I heard a lot about him, Pavle, Patriarch Pavle. I wanted to pay respects and see his where he was laid to rest. And there was a liturgy, and I remember, and probably because I had a lot of mixed emotions, I wasn't... I'm now at this point coming home after 10 years of not being able to travel due to some immigration issues that I had in the United States. It's the father who I haven't seen for 10 years who had passed away without me seeing him. So it was very difficult for me. So naturally, I would be in this state where I would be more internalized my feelings and prayer always helped, and I was at the liturgy. It was a Sunday liturgy, and all I remember, because I didn't pay attention too much to the details of what was happening around, I knew there were somebody's holy relics there. And as I was praying and the liturgy was finished, I naturally came and venerated the holy relics. At the end of the liturgy, I went to the bookstore, as I usually do when I visit the monasteries. It's always something I always like to get, a souvenir or buy a book or candles, and I saw prominently displayed the book about Saint Nektarios, and I remember hearing about him. I remember hearing about him for the first time when I visited the monastery of Saint Anthony in United States, in Arizona, where I used to go a lot and visit a lot, and I remember people talking about him. And when I saw his name, I said, oh, perfect, I'm going to... It was in Serbian as well, the book. I don't know exactly which book it was. I know it was a mixture of different biographies, that original book, including some miracles of his, but it was a book about his life. I bought a book, I went home, and I think on my way back to Los Angeles, after my stay in Serbia, I started reading the book about Saint Nektarios. And clearly, because reading books about other saints always had a strong effect on me, but this was something different, because it was so personal to me, his story. It was so close to my heart that for, I would say, few different reasons, which I would elaborate on. I thought that this has to be a movie and that I would like to make a movie about this. And I believe that this was the right time. Whenever it was to happen from that point on, it would be a film that would be relevant for our generations, for the world that we live in. I had this very strong desire to do that. I sort of had a very clear premise in my head to what it should be about. And from that point on, I for about a year until the next summer, I did a lot of research. I read everything I could get my hands on. That was in English, obviously, and because I didn't speak Greek, I still don't speak Greek that well, unfortunately, I got to learn. I listened to different talks about Saint Nektarios as well, and talked to people that knew a lot about him to gather as much information about his life. And after a year, to say now, now we're going to the summer of 2013, when my husband and I, it was August, we fly to Greece. For me, that was coming to Greece for the first time. His mother is Greek from Athens, and we were invited to come here. We came to Vulemeni Varkiza, this area. That's where my mother-in-law, she lives here. And we visited Island Syros that year with my husband and his brother and his children. Of course, having an outline of the movie at that point, meaning I already wrote a page or two of what I felt the film should be about, I went to Aegina. I remember even me going to Aegina was bumpy road. Everything about this film was, there was always some obstacles around it, but I had this such a strong, clear mission in my head that I just, you know, keep going forwards with it. So I went to Aegina and I went to the tomb of Saint Nektarios and I asked him, I put the papers on his tomb temporarily, of course, I took them back, I didn't leave them there, and asked him to help me because I truly believe that I should make a film about him. And if it's God's will and if it's his will to help me to make it happen, because as we all know, making a film is very difficult task and requires so many things and not let alone film about a saint. You know, that could be an extra challenge. For me, it wasn't an extra challenge. For me, it was an inspiration that was limitless. But I'm sure I knew I was not gonna get the financing easier, very easy for something like this. If we go back to what you asked me, why do you think what was maybe personal to me? The fact that my father had passed away a year before that, and that was something that was very painful for me and very personal. And if we were going to talk about my father, he was a civil engineer who was one of the best in Yugoslavia. At the time, it was Yugoslavia, because when I left, Yugoslavia was still there. And then it became all these different countries that now are currently they're existing right now. I'm not saying that because he was my father. He really was an incredible, he was very skillful at his work. He was demanded by, especially if the foreigners would come and build roads, you know, if the business contract was, if let's say people from Germany would come or Switzerland and they wanted to invest in building the roads in Serbia, they would use him. Because they knew that he was that skillful, there would be no mistakes, there would be no problems. Another thing that my father had, he was an extremely righteous and honest man. To a point where, I'm just going to quote somebody, so it's, we all love our fathers and we all can say our fathers are amazing, but which is a nice thing to say, but I'm talking now about a very exceptional person. And I'm going to quote somebody else, so it doesn't. So somebody would see what the real truth is. A husband of my best friend claims till today that until he met my father, he did not believe that people like this existed. That clearly there was something about my father that was very special. His word was a law. You know, he when he said something, he meant it, he did it. He was satisfied with very little. So what happened when he was naturally being very young and sort of becoming semi-what successful, even though success was never something that he cared about, he was just simply in a certain position because of his skill. He did not follow some unethical, he did not want to be part of some unethical dealings, which often happen in the high positions and in the companies where people like to gain finances in an unethical way. He would actually prevent that. He was loved by simple people, by the workers. So they did not know how to get rid of him. They wanted to get rid of him because he was somebody that reminded them that they shouldn't be doing what they're doing. And that was the reason why they wanted to get rid of him. So I remember one day they decided to send him. There was a building of a road in the northern part of Serbia, and it was extreme wind. And they did that on purpose, and they said he would have to send a workers, a simple people, to climb I don't know how many meters high. And he knew very well that if he does that, the worker could lose his life. So he said, I'm not doing that. I'm not going to be responsible for somebody's life. And that's what they used to take him to the court, as if he was disobedient to the order of the superior. And once he was taken to court, the six false witnesses were brought to the stand. And that's how they got rid of him. And a man of that stature, of that knowledge, simply humbled himself, didn't return evil for evil. People say that even though where I come from, it's not like in the US where you have right to carry a gun. In Serbia, you don't have right to carry a gun, but they say that he actually carried a pistol with him for a while because he was also fearing for his life and the life of his family. And that was temporarily, of course, until things settled down. And he got a job in a suburb of Belgrade in a factory, you know, very humble, very simple, and he worked there until the rest of his days. And he never complained. And I think his story is, I mean, it's in some way parallel to the story of Saint Nektarios of Agina. He had shaped my character a lot, and probably because of him, and living in the place where he lived in, and hearing from everybody, including my mother and everybody around, how can a talent like that ending up having a pension that is as big as a cleaning lady's, you know, and that's such an injustice, and how did he allow himself to get to that point? But one thing about my father, he never cared about material stuff. He was actually happy. He worked, I remember he helped every single person in our building to get top mark in mathematics and physics, you know, when they were going to pass the exams. He never charged anybody for any of that. And he was just a simple man who said, hey, I have, and this is something that says in the psalm, I don't know which psalm, but when I read it, I always remember my father. And I'm going to try to paraphrase it. He says, God, you have given me, you've given them riches and stuff, but you've given me much more. When I go to sleep, I have no fear. And this is what my father had. That basically, that story of my father had, if you talk about something very personal, had struck a chord with me when I read the book about Saint Nektarios. So I think that had a lot to do with me understanding the material on a very personal level, and also being somebody who was an immigrant for many, many years. I mean, we talk about the sense of belonging. If you look at the movie, Saint Nektarios at one point, or for a long time, was not even considered Greek, you know. And I remember it took me 18 years to get my citizenship. That was like a nightmare, you know.
Many Your times, citizenship in the United States?
In the United States. Many times I lived on my faith, you know, that's all I had, which was more than enough. I need to say that. There were parallels. There was experience. Faith has played a very big life a part in my life. Even before I joined Orthodox Church, I wasn't raised Orthodox in the Orthodox Church. I didn't know about it much, but I knew there was somebody out there that took care of me, that I could ask questions, that I can ask for protection. I actually felt the presence, and that's why I, when I left, I always had that with me. I felt I had that with me, and I wasn't afraid, and I tried to do my best. And then in year 2000, after my first son was born, was when I had my first communion and confession. And I in Serbian Orthodox Church in Los Angeles, Church Saint Sava, and I've experienced a presence of grace for about 6-7 hours, where I laughed and cried uncontrollably, and people thought I was drunk. So that's ever since then. I never looked back, and I continued on my path. So that's I hope I've given a little overview of what sort of my connection to this story and to this book.
In your film, we see many different aspects of Saint Nektarios' life. Mm-hmm. For example, both the creative things he has done in Egypt with the local people from the church, who were both Greek and Arabs. Mm-hmm. So he did have a creative work, but also we see the aspect of persecution and the aspect of suffering from constant persecution. Firstly, I would like to ask you about the first part. Mm-hmm. Do you think that Saint Nektarios had a very special approach in his work in the Patriarchate of Alexandria? There is an element that he saw all people as equal. Mm-hmm. In an age where the world system was colonialism, so there was also the British colonialism, but also in some sense Arabs were considered of lesser importance even inside the Christian community. Do you think that Saint Nektarios had a revolutionary vision of human equality based on Christianity, and that he had tried to put that in practice?
That's absolutely correct. And he was a good man, first of all. Okay, we speak about Christianity right now because we are Christians, but it can pertain to any religion, I think.
Yes.
Before we decide to climb on so-called higher levels, we have to examine ourselves and see if we at least have enough human decency to call ourselves human beings. He was a good human being, and being a good human being, and especially somebody who really loved God, he really loved God. Now, he didn't pretend to love God. He really loved God and believed in the words of Christ. He lived it, which means whether you're an Arab or African American or Chinese, you're a human being. And a person of faith, person who really loves God, he doesn't see people differently by their skin color or their society status or whether they're poor or rich. They don't make any distinction between those things. And that's actually a proof that he was a God seeker. And because of that, he was loved by the community. He was loved by both a Muslim community, Arab community, Christian community, because he loved people in general. And he genuinely wanted to help everybody. And I've showed very little at the beginning, but it's based on a true story that he even prayed for poor Muslim Arabs, that there was a story of a baker that he healed him. He couldn't walk, and when they heard that there was a holy man there, they would flock to him, but out of respect for other person's religion. You see how respectful this man was. He would ask, for example, if the person was Muslim, he would ask them to go to their teacher, to imam, and to get a written permission that he's allowed to do prayers for them in the church. And they would go, and once the imam would say, okay, this is a good man, if you think he can help you, he would then pray for them. And he also helped a lot of poor Arab people. And probably because for people that belong to the church, but they're not really people of the church yet, that doesn't mean that they cannot become people of the church if they decide to actually look at the words they're reading every day and dwell on them a little bit more and decide to apply them on their own, in their own life. They have a great treasure to draw from. But unfortunately, in those institutions, there's a lot of politics and a lot of power involved. And one of the main premises of my film from the beginning was that the power destroys human souls, desire for power. Unhealthy desire for power destroys human souls and destroys societies and causes a lot of damage to the person that practices those unvirtues, non-virtues, what's so called, and causes a lot of pain to those that live around. So that was one of the main premises of my movie. That's why I focused on my film. My film started from his exile, unjust exile from Egypt. Unjust is something that a lot of people can relate to. A lot of people, regardless of their background or nationality, can relate to the injustice and unjust treatment, especially if they're trying to do something good, trying to help somebody, try to better this world. And his constant prosecution, unjust prosecution until the end of his life, which a lot of people experience, because this life, whether we like it or not, is going to bring us pain, it's going to bring us suffering. It's just part of this life, part of this world. How much suffering we're going to have clearly depends on us. And I think the Saint Nektarios is an example of a person that can make this world a better place. A person who chooses love and forgiveness because of the enormous faith and love for God that he truly possessed.
How can one forgive? What do you think, after having made this movie, what do you think is the secret for forgiveness? It might be very difficult, but also very easy. What did you think after having made all this endeavor?
Okay, I will try to answer that question. It's not easy to forgive. That's one of the most difficult things to do, is to forgive. And that's understandable, because it's very hard to experience something terrible and to forgive. But if we do not forgive, we're never going to have peace. And we're going to live in a perpetual hell until the rest of our lives. The choice to forgive is a very important one because of that. Because we talk about the freedom, and there is a freedom on different levels. It can be social freedom, but it all starts from a personal freedom. If a person is not spiritually enlightened, they will be racist, they will be mean, they will blame others for their problems. They're going to always find something or somebody to blame, and depending how self-righteous they are, they can even arrive to a point of hurting others because of their beliefs. A person who is humble and who is willing to forgive, as hard as it might be, will find favor in the eyes of God. Believe me, they will get peace that this world cannot give, and they will know in their heart the strength and power of that peace. And that peace, again, I'm saying again, regardless of which religion you belong to or what status you belong to, is something that resonates, and it's felt by those around. And it's only that peace that can create peace in the world. Otherwise, there will be no peace in the world.
Yes, as you said before, your aim was not to do a religious film only for religious people. The film has a large audience. It is more like an existential film. It touches upon the great issues of existence, like forgiveness, love, power, humbleness, and also a lot of political issues. And I think this is a film that could be addressed to people of different religions, different or atheists or Christians or from different religions. Was it a conscious choice on your part to avoid making a religious film and to focus more on the existential issues?
First of all, from my background, I studied in a school called Playhouse West. It's a very good training for actors and directors and writers. A lot of successful people. When I say successful, I don't mean only successful in the terms of commercial success, but people that really had something to offer, people that had talent and that they had something to offer to others in terms of their profession. That came out of that school, and the school derived from the training of Stanford Meisner, who was part of the group theater. He was part of the actor studio, I'm sorry, together with Lee Strasberg and Cheryl Crawford and some other people, and which also derived from the group theater originally, which happened after Stanislavski toured in the United States, and they were quite amazed by his method. So ironically, this man from Russia has brought a very valuable thing to the States, which then some talented people have embraced it and had produced the greatest writers, actors, directors of all times in the United States. They've pretty much formed the industry to a certain degree. So the reason I'm bringing this up, training in that school, in our technique, acting is living truthfully under imaginary circumstances. What everything we did every day when we trained, we focused on the truth. We focused on being honest. And we understood very well that unless you're honest to yourself, unless you can bring yourself to what you're doing, the audience cannot feel it. Having experienced that for quite a few years, and also being a huge fan of Dostoevsky, which I believe that a lot of my ideas and my work has been shaped by him, since I read him since I was a very young girl. When I left Serbia, I left with a pair of jeans, a few shirts, and three books of Dostoevsky. I mean, those books were Crime and Punishment, Possessed, and the short stories, which included White Nights and Dream of a Ridiculous Man. Dostoevsky was somebody I read when I was 16, when I was 14, when I was 18, 20, and so. And again, Dostoevsky was somebody not only that went very deep into human psyche, and I think anybody who is an artist, especially in the world of cinema or acting, it's not only enjoys reading Dostoevsky, but I think it's very helpful for their craft. He had said once to his students, when they asked him, what do you think I should write about? That was towards the end of his life when he was older and when he wrote some of the best of his writings. And the only thing he told them is to write only about things they understand. So my approach to this was extremely human. I try to be as Christian as I can be. I try to be the best person that I can be. I mean, if I can achieve just four things that, to a degree, that Christ had commanded us, which is not to judge anybody, which is to forgive everybody and to have mercy on everybody, and not to be, and not to condemn anybody. If I can get close to that, then I feel that I can, that I've done pretty well. Considering that I'm not somebody who is so great and I don't have many virtues to offer. Again, because of that, I focused on a human level of the story. I wanted people to identify with him, with his sufferings, with the way he dealt with things, so that and in that case, if the audience could identify with him, in that case they could take something from his story, learn something from him, because I think it's a person that we all should learn from.
Yes, yeah, I'd like to point out that, yes,
forgive
please,
me, another
please,
thing, because
please.
You know, one thing that I know from the craft that I've learned, how do we make, to make a good film, you need good drama. And there is a lot of drama here, because drama comes from a conflict, only from conflict of human beings. You cannot dramatize holiness, and you cannot dramatize saintlyhood. You can only dramatize a conflict within a human relation. That's why I focused on that, and I felt if I do the best I can do, maybe I would achieve something that would have some value.
It is true that, of course, you have the experience of communion of the saint with God, mm-hmm. but since this is inside the context of glory, of Christian Eucharist and glory, it is difficult to dramatize. On the other hand, there are consequences of this in the historical life, and these consequences also have to do with politics, but also with pedagogics and psychology. So I have some questions also on these issues. First of all, as you have noted earlier, we have a very specific case of a political identity of Saint Nektarios. He is born in Silibria in the Ottoman Empire, so he belongs to a Hellenism outside the small Greek state that was newly founded. And then he moves to various parts of the Ottoman Empire with Greek population. And he ends in Egypt, and then after being persecuted from Egypt, from the Patriarch of Alexandria, he lives in Greece without an identity of Greek, so he is always a stranger inside mm-hmm. Greece. And what is, it's like, as in theology we call it, the communication of idioms. While he was in Egypt, he was praying, and he was fighting for the cause of the Arabs, who were like mm-hmm. a different race from mm-hmm. Greeks. Mm-hmm. And whereas when he was in Greece, he became himself a stranger because he did not have the identity of a Greek. Mm-hmm. So he was a perpetual nomad and stranger in a very existential sense also. I find that your film does show that, and as you said earlier, this may have to do with your own experiences as well. Do you think that this is both an existential and a political meaning for our days, the experience of being a stranger, a nomad, of lacking a political identity, etc.?
It's a good question, but I will try to answer it the best I can answer that question. A few things come to mind. What's interesting, what made me think when you were talking about it, you know, when we read prayers, when we read psalms, I don't know how many times it says, I'm a sojourner in this world. I'm an alien. I'm here just for time being. I don't belong here, God. Be my shelter and my shield. There is something, there is belonging in this world, in the society of this world, and there is belonging to oneself and to God. I think those are two different things. Ironically, the Lord had said as well that it was in one of the Gospels that he says, I think one of his apostles have pointed this out, and giving an advice to those who listen. He says, you should not judge anybody. Don't be like this. If somebody comes to your house, and maybe has a status, and you put him in a top place on your table, and then somebody who doesn't have much, you place him at the bottom. Already you made a difference. You made a distinction between these two people who really, in the eyes of God, have no difference. They're both human beings. It says, you shame the poor, but don't you understand that the poor are those that God has chosen to be his followers? So, and those who are cast out, and those who are favored by him. So why am I saying this? It's like he must have, being a true man of God, he felt comfortable in the company of those who were simple, who had a Holy Spirit in them, because they were simple and they were not proud and they did not desire high positions and high society. The gifts from God are in direct opposition to power and money, and or even belonging somewhere in this world, that usually those who are so-called forgotten and abandoned are closer, and they seem to even be happier most of the time. If we honestly look around ourselves, and I've met people that have almost nothing. They would give you their last shirt, and they would genuinely do that, and they have a smile on their face. Where I met people that have everything, they're accepted by the society, they have so many riches, they're so miserable that they have nothing else to do but to try to make somebody else's life miserable. It's an interesting thing, but whatever I said right now holds a lot of truth. You know, I cannot speak the full truth, I'm not an authority here on those kind of things, but I believe what I said, it has a point. As we talk about what do you do consciously, I consciously put him, if you watch the movie, you see that every time he gets hurt by those in authority, by those who hold their authority and their importance to such a high extent, and therefore they're bothered by somebody who sees everybody equally. You see, why they always attack Saint Nektarios. He would always go and talk to either a poor man on the street where he would feel at home. Then he would go and speak to the janitor. So it's the simple people that gave Saint Nektarios joy, and they understood him and they loved him. While people in authority, because they had very hard time to find peace and happiness, because they were looking for it in the wrong places, you know, they had a huge issue with him. That's an interesting observation, and it's true.
Two scenes from the movie come to my mind. The one thing is Saint Nektarios' encounter with the personas played by Christos Loulis, who is the head in the Rosarios Academy. And on the one hand, Saint Nektarios is constantly persecuted, but he has found the inner peace. Whereas the head of the academy has a position of power, so he has a constant position, but he lacks inner peace. He cannot find inner peace. He's in constant conflict. And this is a very interesting contrast. How do you think of this detail in the film?
Well, you know, I must be honest about something. For that particular scene, I had in mind Alyosha and Ivan from Brother Karamazov.
I see. It makes sense.
Because that was obviously one of the greatest piece in the literature, and that was in my mind where first of all the Christos is there to represent a lot of people that exist in the world. It doesn't mean those are bad people. We all change, we all going through change, we all searching for love and peace, whether we like it or not. Nobody wants to suffer, nobody wants to experience pain and loneliness. But some people find it in the right places, and some people takes them much longer. One thing about Christos, at least the way I saw it, and even when Saint Nektarios tells him at the end, you're going to be okay, he was honest enough. He recognized the value, even though he disliked Saint Nektarios. He was touched by his sincerity and his honesty, And a person like Christos has a potential of reaching that level because he, as Saint Nektarios says, he stood for something. He wasn't lukewarm. He was pretty
dedicated
to his cause and to what he believed in. He's one of the types of the people in this world that I think might find their way, you know, because of their strong stance. You know, maybe something might happen in their life at one point and which will change their course. It's much harder when I think when somebody is too comfortable in their position and they're not willing to think that much.
The second scene is the one with the beggar in which Saint Nektarios is giving him his shoes. That's what he offers to him. This reminds of the English expression to be in someone's shoes. And this is not so the stance to love and charity is not to have charity from above, but he really gives something to this poor beggar when he himself is very humbled and humiliated by the persecution. So he has a sort of deep empathy. And I think that this scene shows charity as only as a version of very deep empathy.
Well, I can answer this question by asking you a question, if
yes.
you don't mind.
Yes.
Did you notice that people that don't have much are usually more giving?
Yes, that's true.
Than those that have a lot.
That's true. Yes.
That's an interesting observation, isn't it? You know, that a person has more feeling and they maybe understand the other person more.
Yes.
Once person has so much, even if they give, it's usually for the vanity reasons.
Yes.
Not to mention they end up making more money than giving, which is happening nowadays with a lot of charity organizations. But let's not get into that subject because we might lose the beauty of this conversation. Come back to what you've asked me. It's correct that that's true what you said, and also I want to elaborate on something regarding that scene. That scene was also very personal to me because I found myself, I remember when I was in New York City and I was on my own, I didn't have many friends, I would often walk from the 34th Street to the 51st Street in Madison, where I would sit in St. Patrick's Cathedral at the time. I was 19 years old, and I would read either Dostoevsky or do the prayers the best I could know how to do. And basically, I realized that I was friends, there were some beggars around the church that I would often speak to, or I would even sit and spend some really valuable time with. And I felt less lonely with them than I did with some people that I would later have dinner with. And the discussions were about, you know, how successful we're going to become one day and how much money we're going to make. That's one thing. Another thing is that I, when I lived in New York, when I went through, there was a moment when I was really struggling financially and I just came there and it was very difficult for me. And it was in those moments of extreme loneliness and I wouldn't say pain, I would say moments where I did not know where anything was coming, including my next rent or food on my table. Those are the moments that I experienced God the most. And I've physically experienced that. Those are the moments that I have felt, even physically felt warmth sometimes when I had nothing, absolutely nothing. And there was no way out and it didn't look like anything good was going to happen. So that what he's saying, I've kind of put myself in there. I really understood what that means. And I've experienced it there, therefore I put it out there because I know that there is truth to that because I've experienced it myself.
Maybe a lack of security or a lack of fullness that leaves room for faith and for coming out of oneself.
Yes.
The core of the movie is existential, but there are many consequences in psychology, pedagogics, political philosophy or political theology. For example, what is very impressive is the stance of Saint Nektarios in what concerns pedagogy. Of course, we have to remember that we are in the turn of the century, from 19th century to 20th century.
Yes.
So there was an ideal of modernization, but the pedagogic methods were quite old-fashioned. They were based on physical, also physical punishment, etc. But on the with the goal of progress and modernization. And instead of all that, Saint Nektarios, when there is a conflict in the school, in the Rosario, Saint Nektarios does not take part in the conflict, but he does fast himself, and he is fasting until the conflict is resolved. So the people, the young boys, are brought to what we call philotimia, philotimo. To a sort of
self-realization of what's wrong with this.
Yeah, that they have to solve the problem, because otherwise Saint Nectarios will be in a very difficult situation of fasting forever. I don't know.
Yeah, that's humor. that's
like in a hunger strike.
he went on a hunger strike.
We have the existential Christian stance that evil is not something outside, and evil is not something that one has the full evil and the other is the fully virtuous. Evil is something that permeates our small society, or small or large society, and then the stance of the saint is to take the evil on him and say that it is me that have not inspired you enough. So I will fast myself until there is a solution. So this is not an objective morality, that the one is a bad guy and the other is a good guy. It's an assumption of the evil by ourselves, by the saint, until a collective transcendence of the whole body of society. I find this very revolutionary, both in terms of pedagogy and of political coexistence. How did you come with this scene when making this film?
Well, this really happened. You know,
he really
did that, and I found that scene valuable for the film, for the very reasons that you brought up, and now. As we think about this, and you're right, at that time, especially that time, as you say, physical punishments were the norm.
Yes.
And you have this man who says, once the students misbehaved, the principal assistant expects him to order the punishment. He says, I have no other choice but to punish myself. Imagine the students, as you said, how much more powerful was his behavior in bettering and improving the behavior of the students, rather than just implementing flogging or whatever else they were doing at the time. They've never seen anything like that. And therefore, they were in shock. And what he managed to do, again, even though the president of the school and the committee had problems with him, students loved him. He managed to get students to, he was their favorite principal after a while. He not only helped the students, during his term, students started to learn more. They didn't have a disdain for learning. Basically, he showed love, you know, he treated them with love and respect in many, and this is what's missing a lot in the society nowadays. I think that if people were treated more that way, there will be less anger, less misunderstanding. And again, I'm going back that this extreme example, and because it's so extreme, it might be needed nowadays. It might inspire few to make personal choices in their life and therefore better the society. As we know, a lot of saints, not just Saint Nectarius, and if we read the books on the Holy Fathers and the saints, they really believed that they're guilty for everybody else. They truly believed they were carrying the sins of others. And they really believed that if somebody else was misbehaving, it's somehow their fault. Not just theoretically, not just, they really arrived, closer they arrived to God, closer they arrived to the source of light. Because, you know, when closer you get to light, you can see better, right? Further you're away from the light, you're in the darkness. You know, closer you get to the light, you see better. And then you realize, wait a second, we are all one. So if there is a person or a group of people, they're in pain or they're acting out, it's also my fault. And I think that this is a very important thing to understand when you talk about pedagogy, when you talk about those kind of things. That doesn't mean that you should not implement discipline. Like he was implementing discipline. You have to have a. That's why he says the best the balance is the best is to have a balance between kindness and authority. You cannot only have authority, because just having an authority and cruelty that you know, human beings respond to love. That's the most powerful weapon, is love. It's not authority and discipline, even though sometimes it's necessary, but if you don't have the other, just having that, it's not gonna change anything. It's not gonna affect anybody. It's just gonna be a chaos. And as you can see nowadays, I don't know if we all can, I'm sure everybody can agree. I mean, you can turn the television on. And what our children and the new generations are learning from the moment they turn the TV on is to blame somebody else for something, and to think that somebody else is bad while they're good. And even this whole idea of how somebody else is bad and I'm good, that's a false statement. It's only God can decide who is, nobody is fully good and nobody is fully bad. That doesn't exist. So we can all either make a choice to turn towards the sun, towards the light, and slowly make the steps towards it, so we can see clearly first about ourselves. And once we can see more clearly about ourselves, then maybe we'll be able to help others and tell something to somebody else, rather than living in a complete darkness and just pointing fingers. And the result of that could be really bad. And we've seen them through history of our humanity.
Like scapegoating. Yes. And Saint Nektarios was himself a victim of this.
He was, but he didn't allow for that to make him into you know, he didn't allow that. That's his victory.
Yes.
He didn't allow for that to turn him into somebody who's going to start judging and hating people. He, on the contrary, he stuck to his premise. He stuck to what he believed in, and we saw his reward at the end.
Speaking about political theology, also there's a very subtle distinction. When they were accusing him, he always accepted it without justifying himself, without any sort of self-justification. However, when his spiritual daughters were in danger, he did support them with the means of this age, even with the judicial system. Mm-hmm. Of his age. This was totally another stance. Instead of letting them dissolve, he did try to support his spiritual children, even through law. This is a very interesting contrast in the film. How would you comment on it?
I don't think that's contrast. I think that's the right thing to do. And
yes.
I think it makes sense. I can make a choice to turn another cheek.
Yes.
And I better make that choice. You know why? Because ultimately, at the right time, at the right moment, obviously. I'm not saying now to people just to put their hands down and not defend. That's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about when the world comes at you, when things come at you, turning another cheek means don't react back. You should react back if you can change something, but if you cannot really change anything, you just, you know, revenge and things like that, that they're not going to bring peace. They're not going to solve anything. They're just going to bring more bloodshed and misery. So in that sense, turning another cheek is a good thing to practice for many reasons, especially spiritual reasons. But when you're responsible for somebody else, for a human being, we are supposed to protect others. We're supposed to care for others. So if somebody is, what he said, if somebody is trying to hurt somebody because of me, especially because of me, it's normal that I would defend them. It would be cowardly not to turning another cheek when somebody does something to you and taking a higher way is bravery. But allowing somebody to suffer because of you, that's cowardice. That's not, at that point, you're supposed to protect your child, your brother, your sister, even if you're going to lose your life. You know, that's what Jesus did for us. He came to die. He came to serve, and he came to die for us.
The Christ did protect the apostles.
Exactly. But he never attacked those that attacked him. Saint Nektarios lived exactly by what he preached.
So there are these elements of, let's say, of political theology. For example, one can remember the saying reproduced by Nikolai Berdyaev that my bread is a carnal thing, but the bread of my brethren is a spiritual issue. But on the other hand, we also have in the movie the existential issue, which is also an eschatological one. As time goes by, in the end, Saint Nektarios cannot protect fully his spiritual children, and when this accusation amass, he's more and more apophatic, and in the end, he just points upwards, like points to God, without even speaking. He just lets all this evil happen of the persecution of the nuns. Would you say that this is the, let's say, the eschatological foundation of forgiveness, the fact that only God is the judge, a man or woman cannot be a judge inside history? So forgiveness is based on the fact that we cannot judge evil ourselves, but we can only have confidence in the future.
I will try to answer this because yes. I'm not a theologian.
Yes.
Forgive me, I have to say that.
No, forgive me.
It's okay. Like listening to it, I can learn so much, but I will answer with my own whatever ability I have.
Of course.
I think if you, well, that particular thing happened towards the end of his life.
Yes, exactly.
That particular thing happened after his experience injustice, after injustice, after injustice, after injustice. At one point, you get to a point as a human being.
Yes.
You don't give up fighting, but you just simply, you have to just, at this point, you have to let God protect you. Because there's nothing else that you can do anymore. Because you don't have that power anymore. I mean, maybe there in the certain moments you have power to protect yourself if you can't do it. But at this point, after so much, I mean, if you look at everything that happened to him, first they exiled him. Then he couldn't even get a position to work. He was hungry. Then he was in school, barely, still prosecuted and reminded how he was doing something that he never did. Then he went to the monastery to finally find peace, and over there they wouldn't even let him have a monastery. And then they accused him of even more evil things that not only he didn't do, it's just completely insane. So at that point, where it comes to that level, you just say, my life belongs to you at this point, you know, to the one who said, don't be afraid of those who can only kill your body, but cannot do anything else after that. Be afraid of the one who can take your body, but has the power to place your soul where, God forbid, anybody ends up going.
I would then like to ask you some things as you're a director. First of all, there is this aging of Saint Nektarios in the movie, but at the same time, while he ages, he somehow becomes more charismatic, and the physical aging, which is shown maybe by some sort of makeup, and also through the very good acting by Iris Servetalis. At the same time, we have a sort of growth of this grace of God. How could you express this in the film by some technical means?
I can answer. I believe I can, from the professional standpoint. Yes. What, first of all, what we try to do, and when I spoke to my director of photography, Panayotis Vasilakis, who is, it was amazing to work with him. And I was very lucky to have worked with him and with Aris and with everyone on the set, including Evan Athena, costume designer, Spiros Laskaris, set designer. These people are, not only they're extremely talented, but they've really did it from their heart. And that's why it shows in the movie. So to first go from the beginning, when I found the DP that was right for the film and that was willing to do it, which was Panayotis, one thing that was amazing, we really saw things, after he read the script, we agree. It's not agreeing for the ego's sake, it's we saw the things in the same way, in the same light, which means we both agree that this film has to be done from the inside out, that that we had to focus very much. I told him I wanted to focus on the character of Saint Nektarios. I wanted people to feel what he feels. This was the number one thing of making this film. One of the ways, apart from the way I directed actors and the way they acted, including number one, Ari Servetalis, we did some things. For example, it was we decided to use the aspect ratio 1.66, which is unusual. It was used in the older films, in the black and white films. And what that aspect ratio is, basically the screen is not as wide, it's a little more narrow, and there is more space above actor's head. And that makes the audience focus not on the surroundings of the story, but it draws the audience into the character and what the character feels. And everything that was done with the costumes, with the set design, was done to support the emotional value of the scene. Saint Nektarios, because of this space above him, was somebody who was always intuitively, subconsciously looking for something higher. He was reaching for heavens, for the higher state of consciousness, you know, right? Then again, with the makeup, which I believed had to be subtle. And now this doesn't only go for makeup, goes for the costume design, which I have to really specify this. Evan Athena has done a superb job, because the palette of colors that she used was so important for this film. It was in line with what we were trying to do. And also, we decided from the beginning to desaturate the color of the film. Also to stay truthful to the story, to stay truthful to the suffering of Saint Nektarios, which this film emphasizes a lot. And all I could have done, I know many times I've heard from certain individuals, but this holiness, this light, I said, there's no such thing, you cannot put light. Like if I put a light bulb in the film, it doesn't mean there is a light in the movie. The light can come only from the truth. So what all of us focused was on being as honest and truthful through makeup, through performances, through colors, through costume design. And I've told certain people, they've come at me with this comment about light and holiness, which I've constantly tried to debunk the fact that you cannot try to put that in the film. That's just simply impossible. I've asked them, when you do a when you somebody who works on getting a prayer of the heart, which is a prayer that repeats by itself without doing anything in your heart, do you think that you get that because of all the things that you do right, or you get that because it's God's will? And the answer to that is obvious. You achieve that only if God, the Creator, the eternal light, decides to give it to you. So the same way, my approach was to do everything I can do as honestly as possible, all of us together. And if it's God's will, He can drop, He can put a light in the film. But it's ultimately His will, not my will. And that's the, if you ask me how did I achieve that, whatever I achieved with my human ability was to use my knowledge to tell the story the best possible way, to make it as human as possible. But if there is something like that in this film, then I was just somebody who, what happened, maybe if it's true what people are saying, then the one that sees everything, you know, he could have maybe awarded our hard work and put a glimpse of light in it, because he's the only one who can do it, not me.
As a director, how do you evolve in the film from scenes of encountering evil, like the persecution, to scenes of grace, like the miracle in the end with the patient who managed to to walk, etc.? Is it difficult to evolve from the one to the other?
Well, I think it went to that. I think it was this bubble that was going to burst one way or another. And because of the choices that Saint Nektarios made, he gained resurrection. This extreme suffering and persecution and injustice and his ability, because of this great faith that he had, had led to him actually arriving to a point where he gained the eternal life. And the man who walked, which he really walked, this is a fact, we all know that, he walked in Aretea Hospital here, there is a room where that happened, is also a metaphor and a symbol of resurrection that we are all hoping for.
In the film you have, in the casting, there are actors, a lot of Greek actors, mm-hmm. but also actors from Russia, from the United States, and from different countries in general. Mm-hmm. And you have chosen English as the language of the film. Why did you make that choice? You have received some criticism that for example, Greek actors did not have, except maybe Christos Loulis, they did not always have a perfect English accent. Mm-hmm. Why did you choose to have English as the language of the film, but with actors coming from Greece, from Russia, etc., mm-hmm. from many different countries?
Well, again, I go back. There are a couple of reasons for this, not only one reason. I initially thought this should have been done in English.
Yes.
And also, I was aware that if I was going to do it in English, it had to be in accents, because otherwise it will be fake. Yes. You cannot make a film about Saint Nektarios and him speaking in a perfect English
exactly.
or perfect American accent. That would just automatically
alienate
all any kind of possibility of a truthful storytelling.
Yes.
So you could have done it two ways.
Yes.
Yes, it could have been done in Greek, absolutely. And it either Greek or English with the accents.
Right.
Because of the international potential of this film, and because I wanted to make a film that people, that not a film that there's a cliche, mm-hmm. what people usually do, that you kind of watching this movie that's happened at that time, and therefore you're gonna watch it from the outside in. I wanted to make the film that you are there, you feel like it's happening right now. And that's something that I told my director of photography before we started to film. It was a very clear thing that I made, that I want people, when they watch this film, I want them to feel like it's not happening in 1920s or 1800s. I want it to feel like it's happening right now. I don't want them to think of the time, of the space. Yes, we have to be truthful to the time and space, but so we don't show the false material, which will take away from the truth. But I feel that that element of speaking in English not only can reach a broader audience, but it has a slightly modern touch that it's in some way more appealing to the younger audience. Because this film is made not only for people that go to church, this film is made for people that don't believe, for people of different faiths, and I think it has something unique because of that. And also, even if I wanted to make it in Greek, I wouldn't have gotten finances to make it. So I guess it was Alexios Kakoulidis as well for this to happen.
You made the film during the COVID pandemic.
Oh, yes.
How was the situation you had all these different actors from the United States, Greece, Russia, Serbia probably, etc. And at the same time, you had the COVID pandemic.
That was just another very big obstacle.
Yes.
First of all, COVID is something that I pray it goes away, and my heart goes out to everybody who has suffered and lost their loved ones. I hope that we can get a grasp on this, and I hope it doesn't cause as many problems in the near future, at least, as it caused already. But so that's a priority. Not my film is less important than that. More important is for COVID to go away, so people can be safe and have a better life. But apart from that, yes, COVID was just another obstacle. We were set to make a film, start shooting on March 15th, and that was the exact date when everything went into lockdown in Greece. So even though we had this long preparation, Aris's beard was growing. And only another thing I was saying, well, your beard is just going to grow even more. You're going to be even more truthful at this point until we end up getting permission to film. So that happened on June 8th after, I believe, that was 3 months. And there were a lot of restrictions. Everybody had to follow we followed the guidelines. We really made sure everybody was safe. I'd say maybe by the prayers of Saint Nektarios, no one contracted COVID during the filming on our film, not one crew member or an actor. It was this extra obstacle. But interestingly enough, I really believe, because this is the film of somebody whose life was really difficult and really hard, I believe that this extra layer of obstacle has given us an extra ability to channel his suffering even more truthfully. In this case, it actually worked in our favor.
Okay, maybe one final question. What are your projects for the future now we hopefully we're traversing the last stages of the COVID pandemic? Hopefully, it's
hopefully,
unsure.
Hopefully, yes.
What are your projects for afterwards?
Okay, there are a couple of projects that I've written before. I have written a story about the life of Greta Garbo, a famous movie star from 30s and 20s. And this is the script that I have written before I wrote Man of God. In movie business and in life in general, you never know what happens first and how things happen. So I put that one on hold. Because a film about Saint Nektarios, the doors were opening for that one, and I went along with it. And to be honest, that's probably the closest to my heart, and what enabled it actually gave me a certain amount of confidence as a director after working on such a sensitive subject, as you can imagine. So hopefully, I will get to do that film. I originally wrote that movie as a vehicle to me as an actress, but after directing Man of God, I really don't have any. I realized after reading a script after so many years, I'm going to be a director this time of this film, and hopefully find a wonderful actress to portray her life. I also there is a movie that I haven't written. It's called Dead Serious. It's a film that deals with domestic violence, something that is also very relevant, and that I will hopefully direct. And there is another story that I'm developing. It's about Saint Moses Murin, and the title is Moses the Black, which I feel is also a relevant story in our times. A man who was practically a gang member, a robber, a murderer, who had changed his life completely to become a saint, and not only become holy, but died willingly for the good causes at the end of his life. I think it will inspire many.
Thank you so much for the interview, for the very rich interview. And
thank you.
I wish you every success with your future plans. We all wish you. Thank you.
Thank you.